Hachette Audio presents Invisible to Invaluable, Unleashing the Power of Midlife Women, written by Jane Evans and Carol Russell, and read by the authors. Introduction: The Women of Our Time. Have you ever read something so beautiful and thought-provoking you had to stop everything and sit with it for a while? In the early days of lockdown, when everyone was in a state of shock, two storytellers stopped, sat in the sunshine, marvelled at the bird song we never usually got to hear, and pondered the words of a great African-American poet who took our breath away.
Normal never was. Our pre-corona existence was not normal. Other than we normalised greed, iniquity, exhaustion, depletion, extraction, disconnection, confusion, rage, hoarding, hate and lack. We should not long to return, my friends. We are being given a chance to stitch a new garment, one that fits all of humanity and nature. Sonia Renee Taylor.
The reason why these words held so much power for us at the start of lockdown was because they were sentiments we'd been trying to express for years. We knew a change was coming, but we didn't know what form it would take. We discussed the future at length, Jane, the optimist who jumped into the tech startup world with awe, and Carol, with her down-to-earth sense of community, questioning where we'd all fit in. We never imagined it would be a pandemic that would herald the clash between the old and the new. Old systems, new tech, old energy sources, new renewable energy, old ideas, new concepts, old and new, left and right, black and white, man and woman, young and old. No middle, anywhere. Except us. Women aged between 45 and 70 are both young and old. We have a life well lived and half a life to create. We're past our childbearing years with quarter of a century of work years ahead, but we don't exist. We're skipped over. The stages of a woman's life are depicted in the media as little girl, troubled teenager, sex object, career woman, mum, old woman waiting to die. It's not the media's fault we don't exist. It runs much deeper than that. It's societal. Ageism is first detected in children as young as three, and who can be surprised when they're fed a constant diet of old hags and witches? It gets even uglier with all the airbrushing, body shaming, and female competition that's inflicted on us from our teens. It's no wonder it all rises to a climax of Botox, fillers, skin lighteners, and laser skin removal at the first sign of a wrinkle or age spot. We're taught to fear the passage of time, not celebrate it. And we're not even old. A more realistic image of today's older woman would not be as a wicked witch or sweet old granny. It would be as a mum. We're having kids later, with a hell of a lot of us full-on parenting till well into our 60s. And we're doing a hell of a lot more than that too. This book is a celebration of what midlife women do, who we are, what we're capable of, and how much we have to give to the world. It's a mishmash of the conversations we've had over the years, with stories and observations of the women who surround us and those who came before us. Both of us have written with a pile of much-loved and well-thumbed books beside us that tell the stories of the history and culture that shaped us, as well as the myths that defined us. We share the stories of women we admire, ideas and research that excite us, and a few tweets that made us laugh along the way. Both of us are now uninvisible. But we're not writing our stories as a guide to how we became seen and heard. We're all part of the uninvisibility story, and we're writing to show that even if we feel like we've hit rock bottom or have disappeared entirely, there is a way back for all of us. Our own personal experiences and situations vary wildly. This book is a call for us to all come together by recognizing our strengths and talents to make a difference in our own worlds with our own words. For those who are delicate about swearing, sorry. We believe in freedom of expression, so you might have to pardon our French at times. And yes, we are challenging the old systems. This book travels from the start of time to the start of the future. We joke it's a guide to dismantling the patriarchy by the women who made it wobble. The saddest thing about the invisibility of our incredible generation is no one knows our stories and how much we've achieved. We know it's possible to change the world. We've never stopped. We've even got the baddies on the run.
It's not Me Too. It's not just sexual harassment. It's an anti-patriarchy movement. Time's up on 10,000 years of recorded history. This is coming. This is real. Steve Bannon.
This book is dedicated to Verna Wilkins, who taught us how to fight with a pen, and Mavis Russell, who armed Carol for the fray. Invisible, The Return of the Invisible Woman, Jane Evans. In 2018, I saw a magnificent woman on the tube. I'm pretty sure nobody else saw her. She was in her 50s, with bright purple hair, Doc Martens, and a pack of tenor lady pads perched proudly on her lap. I laughed. She had my respect. She knew it. She actually started a movement. You see, she caught me at the peak of my invisibility, at the point I was about to give up. I'd tried for 3 years to get a job in the ad industry, an industry I'd starred in for over 30 years, an industry that claimed to be taking seriously the fact that in 2015, only 3% of the world's creative directors, the people who ultimately decide what we see in commercials, were women. I was the most ridiculously overqualified candidate. I'd created some of Australia's most loved brands and campaigns, had a bank of awards, and had run my own agency with clients like Revlon and Maserati. I was back in London where I started my career with glowing recommendations from global heads of companies. I'd see headhunters who would say how desperately the industry needed female leadership, only to never hear from them again. In those 3 years, I applied for something like 180 jobs. I went for a total of 5 interviews. I was met with comments like, "I'd give you a job, but you'd end up the old woman at the back of the creative department doing the shit no one else wants." Or, "We'd give you a job, but we think you'd be bored." And my personal favourite, "He was excited by your 50-something female awesomeness, but there was not enough supercurrent, big-thinking, innovation-centric, high-level conceptual, tech-friendly work." Whatever that means. My industry has changed. It has fallen in love with data and digital natives and fetishizes youth. The average age in an advertising agency is 33.9, and the thought of a midlife woman in their midst horrifies them. I started my career with the fabulous author and producer Joan Ellis. When she embarked on a new copywriting job in her early 50s, the young male creative team quipped, "Is it bring your granny to work day?" As Joan recounted the story, we both sort of laughed, then sighed. We were both the first girls in our respective creative departments. We were pioneers when it really was the wild, wild west. Naturally, all that sexism and misogyny we faced was just a joke. We really did try to smile more. But we're way too old for drama these days, and we're not putting up with ageism. We just roll up our sleeves. "I had them eating their words within a week," Joan said, with a complete lack of imposter syndrome that can only come with decades of experience. Experience that tells us the ad industry hasn't changed, it's just lost the plot. I've always believed that my job is to tell cool stories that get people to buy stuff. And the fact is, women over 45 buy 50% of everything. So surely clients should be interested in the people who buy half their stuff. So I took out a loan, went to every startup incubator in London, and started a new agency, thinking I had the magic formula. I didn't. I was enthusiastically introduced to the head of planning at a major brand. I had the coolest influencer on board with a massive cross-generational audience who had a huge year coming up. This was the young exec's response to my introduction. "Just want to be upfront about this, which is our target consumer is 19 and under. If anything, we'll be going younger. That's not to say the mature market isn't interesting and important to us, but we have to prioritise based on our strategic goals." It seems the under-19 market is more important to marketers than the women who pay for almost everything for the under-19s. What's more, they don't even have time to talk to us. I knew right then and there I was a goner. I'd tried everything. I couldn't repay the loan and my landlady was about to issue an eviction notice. Then I saw the punk tenor lady on the tube. I knew I was the only one who spotted her, and I knew I was the only one who noticed what was sitting on her knee and the message she was sending. At that precise moment, I knew the universe had dropped the storyteller in the middle of the story. And what a story. I've travelled from having a cup of tea at the food bank to high tea at St James's Palace. Since 2015, I've been to places no female advertising creative ever goes, let alone comes back from. such as the job centre and being coached by one of their business mentors, applying for housing benefits. Honestly, I've applied for multi-million dollar mortgages that had less paperwork and stress, and spending a few days in the Maudsley Psychiatric Hospital in South London. Believe it or not, that situation is only about the third stickiest I've found myself in. I'm no stranger to waking up in a mental hospital, piecing together how I got there. I rarely talk about my mental illness and I never give it a name. My psychiatrist puts it best. In ancient times, you'd be sat in the middle of the village and protected till the visions subside. I do not know why I have visions that sometimes make it impossible to live in modern society, but I do know the trigger. Men fucking with my career. After my third visit to the psych ward, it wasn't hard to work out precisely when and how patriarchal sexism had knocked me out this time. The way I survived those mornings of waking up in a psych ward is exactly the way I handled finding myself at the food bank. Stop, take a big deep breath, look around you, listen. Now why are you here? A couple of years into my unemployment, as I sat clutching a couple of much-needed plastic bags in a local church with a very lovely white middle-class Christian woman praying for me, I realised I was the only woman with all my teeth and the only one with the ability to get out. Even though the ham sandwiches, sponge cake and tea were manna from heaven, and, as a single menopausal mum of girls going through puberty, a month's worth of tampons, pads and deodorants were a godsend. I swore I was getting out and never coming back. More than that, I was damn well going to make sure I could stop as many other women in my position from needing to be there either. Because the worst thing about invisibility is you think you're alone. It's easy to believe you're worthless, and in some perverse way, maybe even think you deserve it. That's what goes through the minds of all abused women. And we're a generation abused by the patriarchy because they let us in, well, as white girls anyway, but made absolutely no concessions to accommodate us. We were allowed on the pitch, but no one told us the rules. We had to make it up as we went along, all while playing on the slanted side with the sun in our eyes. Only the toughest survived, and you just have to hear a few of our Me Too stories to know that many of us lived through a nightmare. Now women over 55 are the biggest group of female suicides in the UK. That's a figure you just don't hear, and it's the ultimate cost of invisibility. Nobody knows or cares when we disappear. But we don't have to. It's physically impossible to be invisible anyway, and it's a lot like being pregnant. Once you're in the same situation, all of a sudden the world seems to be filled with women just like you. In the early days of the Uninvisibility Project, I was having a meeting with a young female PhD student who was working on wearable tech for older women. I know, I'm over 50. I'm not even supposed to know what wearable tech is. During a lull in our conversation, the well-dressed, attractive woman on the table next to us sighed deeply, took a sip of her cappuccino and said to her obvious lifelong best friend, "Well, the interview went really well, but I know they'll give it to some 30-year-old. The friend didn't contradict her or give her useless platitudes. We all just sat there in the glaring silence of an unfair truth. That's a silence that shouldn't be there. I may have been invisible to people who could employ my talents, but I could never be invisible to the people who really know what I'm capable of. There's one place on this earth where I've been shouting my journey of underemployment from the rooftops: Twitter. It didn't take me long to build a following of influential women to start the ball rolling. The Uninvisibility Project began with a tweet to see if there were actually any women over 50 who were employed full-time to create ads in London agencies. It was retweeted 64 times and greeted with responses like "hen's teeth and unicorn tears, easier to find," and "good luck with that." From that tweet, I got 8 names. Now, there may be a few more creative women who are afraid to tell the industry their age, which is sad, because we become even more invisible when we deny our own existence. Fortunately, 4 of the 8 agreed to tell their stories and were very candid, but there were a lot of stories they could not tell. 3 of the 4 women were under gag orders. In fact, between those 4 women, there had been no less than 11 legal actions. I wasn't fighting for my career. I was fighting for my rights, says Janetta Lewin, a woman who learned to trade at London's Royal College of Art in the 60s and is still the coolest cat you could ever hope to meet. But she can't tell you what she experienced, what she did about it, why she did it, or how she successfully litigated. Women like Janetta may be visible, but they've been silenced. They fought sexual harassment and assault, bullying, ageism, and stolen ideas, but they can't tell us how. They don't want to speak for retribution. They want the gag orders removed so they can tell their stories to ensure the women who follow them don't share the same discrimination and abuse. The saddest thing about their stories is everyone thought she was alone in her experience. I knew they weren't. And I knew this wasn't just an advertising tale. I reached out and found 11 more women, from comedians and models to the indomitable sex tech pioneer Cindy Gallup, and a swimming teacher from Brixton who told their inspiring and powerful stories. 40 days and 40 nights after the initial tweet, I single-handedly launched the Uninvisibility Project. I found 15 women, wrote their stories, photographed them, built a website, created a social media campaign, got a couple of PR pieces, and hashtag Uninvisibility had over 2 million views in our first week alone. The Uninvisibility Project went from strength to strength. Our audience grew rapidly and were highly involved. We joked we weren't building an audience, but recruiting an army. Almost a year into the campaign, we'd started to change the narrative, but no one was prepared to put their money where our mouth was. We had to run a GoFundMe just to survive. One of the brilliant women on our site couldn't pay her rent. Another was filing for bankruptcy, but couldn't afford the filing fee. And one was being evicted. Me. Then everything changed. The world stopped and took a breath. COVID gave everyone an opportunity to look at the world through a new lens. When the first lockdown started, this book was already written and on its final edit. I tore it up. Because ideas that were previously pure hypotheses, like running a home is like running a business, were now being perfectly illustrated by our shared experience. In our pandemic world, life has changed, business has changed, we have changed. This coming together has also allowed us to recognise the experiences we do not share. Black Lives Matter made us all listen. Of course, some of us will always be too stupid or selfish to care, but everyone got the message and it's crystal clear. Even those of us who pride ourselves on our inclusivity quickly changed our course to represent and collaborate with our exhausted black friends, colleagues, and allies. Meet Carol Russell, one of my best friends in the whole wide world. I first met Carol in 2014 when we sat next to each other in a writer's room at the National Film and Television School, NFTS. I'd just arrived back in the UK and was trying my hand at writing things a little longer than 30 seconds. Carol was already a highly experienced TV writer. She'd enrolled in Write the Pilot course to force herself to sit down without distractions to damn well get her latest brilliant script down on paper. After hearing the writers pitch their projects, we were both attracted to each other's ideas. Both were high-concept supernatural stories set in the real world. But it was over a cup of tea we really bonded over a shared recognition of the universe working overtime. I made the classic white girl mistake of asking my new black acquaintance if she knew another black friend of mine. But this wasn't just any old friend. This was a woman who played a massive part in forming my view of the world. I felt blessed to have grown up next door to her. She was my hero. It turned out Carol didn't just know her, she knew her well. This remarkable shared connection became a cornerstone for the new book. For the last 6 years, Carol and I have a pact. We only answer the phone to each other if we have a couple of hours to spare. We have stories to share and new worlds to create. We could natter for days about our characters, our plots, and our lives, all completely entwined, as the best stories always are. But nobody wanted to hear them. I watched Carol work on project after project that fell in a heap because white people kept telling her what her story should be. She watched me fight for my career as young white people told me it was over. We understood that even though our lives were different and our experiences poles apart, we both shared the frustration of being midlife women in a world that had no use for us. So now we're sitting down and turning those 6 years of phone calls putting the world to rights into words. Invisible to Invaluable has been written with joy as the world moves beneath our feet. We know that the next few years are going to be challenging and change can mean a cruel roll of the dice for many. But with a whole new world to create, this book is a call for the world to see us and a rallying cry for the generation who've changed the world before. It's time to step up to the plate and do it again. But this time, it's for real.
Chapter 2. Inaudible. The Unheard Woman Roars. Carol Russell. One of the most common complaints about me to my parents when I was in primary school was, put bluntly by the teachers who didn't like me, Carol talks too much. Those teachers called me disruptive and told my parents that I wouldn't let the other children do their work. What none of them could ever say, though, was that I hadn't done my work. The teachers who liked me put it this way. Carol's a bit of a chatterbox. There was one teacher, Sister Bernadette, who adored me, and I her. She understood me. Sister Bernadette, who I had twice in primary school, once in year two and then again in year six, loved my enthusiasm. She also understood that I wasn't just chatting to the other kids at my desk. I was trying to help them with their work. What she also knew was that I needed more work, more challenging work. But she wouldn't have disagreed with the teachers who said I talked a lot. She was also the teacher who persuaded the head teacher to allow me to put on a play in year three. It was The Emperor's New Clothes. I wrote it, directed it, was the titular emperor, and even organised the costumes. Yes, including the nude costume, which consisted of the white vest and navy blue knickers we had to wear for PE. It was a hit, and the other kids talked about it for days after. That should have told me I was going to train as an actor-director and become a playwright and a screenwriter. So you can imagine what it's been like to discover that I am inaudible. Looking back, my inaudibility began when I hit puberty. I was a girl, and I was black in Britain, which meant that none of the career avenues open to my white school friends were open to me. Then a wonderful thing happened. Work with me now. The beginning of this story doesn't sound too promising, but it does get better. I was 13 years old, and I had come top in the end-of-year exams for the second year running, which dragged me out of the bottom stream of my year, which I shouldn't have been in, up through the middle and into the top stream. And for this feat, my father had bought me a Parker fountain pen. I loved that pen. Back in the day, it was the pen of pens. The following term, because of my position in my year's rankings, I got to choose which subjects I was going to take, and I was guaranteed to be in the top stream. One of the subjects I chose was chemistry, and as I was in the top stream, I was taught by Miss Stevenson. I'll never forget her name. We were 6 weeks into the first term, and I noticed that Miss Stevenson had exactly the same pen as me as she marked some of my work. Her pen even had her name engraved on it in silver. It made me really proud that we had the same pen. I can't remember how long after I noticed that we had the same pen, but Miss Stevenson and the head teacher, Sister Mary Joseph, came into one of my classes and she pointed to the pen I had in my hand, saying, "There it is, that's my pen," in front of everyone in my class. I tried to explain that it wasn't her pen, it was my pen, that my father had bought it for me as a present, but I didn't get very far. She wasn't listening. Seems I was inaudible. Sister Mary Joseph took the pen out of my hand and handed me a letter to my parents with an appointment to see her at the end of the week. That evening after school, I prepared an evening meal seasoned by my tears. My parents were going to kill me. As immigrants, the last thing they needed was to take time off work because I'd somehow got myself in trouble. I gave my mother the letter after she'd finished her meal, and she went ballistic. My father arrived soon after, and he was more measured. He asked why they had to turn up at my school, and I explained about the pen and the mistake I knew had been made. I ended my explanation with, "Miss Stevenson's pen's got her name on it, Christine Stevenson." My father told my mother not to worry. He would go to the school to keep the appointment, so she didn't have to book time off. I didn't know what the plan was. All I knew was that I wasn't dead. A few days later, I was called out of class to go to Sister Mary Joseph's office, and when I got there, my dad was waiting for me. I wasn't there but a minute before we were called into her office. Miss Stevenson was there, stood on Sister Mary Joseph's right-hand side, hands clasped grimly in front of her, lips pursed. My father extended his hand. It wasn't taken. He sat before being asked. I sat beside him. As Sister Mary Joseph laid out the accusation against me, I snuck a glance at Miss Stevenson. She looked furious and smug. When Sister Mary Joseph was done, my father asked to see the pen. He explained that he had bought one for me that was exactly like this one. "I have the receipt for it." Then he took out his wallet, removed a receipt from it, put it on the table, and slid it over to Sister Mary Joseph. As she was looking at it, he said to Miss Stevenson, "I understand that your pen has your name on it, Christine Stevenson, I believe, engraved on it. Is that right?" When she said yes, he turned the pen in his hand, examining the smooth petrol blue surface, and then said, "Right. So could you explain to me how my daughter removed your name from this pen and managed to repolish it like new?" I can never be sure what happened in that room next because I was sent out to wait for my father. When he eventually came out of the office, he had my pen in his hand. He told me to go and get my bag, and he took me with him to work. That night, I overheard a conversation between my parents and heard my father say, "You see how it's going, Mavis? We cannot allow them to criminalize our children. If I hadn't had the receipt to show the headmistress, they would have called the police on her." A few short months after that, I was on a plane with my mother and brother to Jamaica. Now, Jamaica wasn't perfect. To this day, it carries the scars of colonialism on its body and in its people, like many ex-colonies. But after the initial shock of leaving my friends and father behind, I quickly settled into the place where my confidence grew with each and every day, even with the other prejudices that were present due to our colonial history. For 7 brilliant years, I wasn't inaudible. But after studying at the Jamaica School of Drama in the Cultural Training Centre, now the Edna Manley College of Visual and Performing Arts, I returned to the UK, to a UK which was just about to explode due to so-called race riots in 1981. A UK where those who had been inaudible were continuing in the footsteps of those who raised their voices to fight for our rights as women and people of African descent. That I am still inaudible today is a testament to the enduring power of sexism and racism. These days there's a word for that, misogynoir, an ingrained prejudice against women who are black. Add ageism and classism to that, you've got a full house. But, and there's a big but, I've never been one to just lie down and take it. The women whose shoulders I stand on have never just taken it. Even when we were forced to work in the fields of America and the Caribbean, we looked for ways to resist and found them. It's said that you can't get over a wrong until it's been named, acknowledged, and owned, because if you can't say what you're fighting against, you can't change it. I would add that if you see things you can do to make a material difference, give it a go. At the very least, it's action, not suffering in silence. Which leads me to talking about the actions I'm taking today. Unlike my friend Jane, I didn't suddenly hit an age and become inaudible. Those of us who have grown up in families of African descent or ethnically diverse families have all heard the saying, you'll have to work 10 times as hard to get half as far as your white counterparts. Some of us didn't want to believe our parents when they told us this, but we soon learnt the truth of it as we left school and tried to get into arenas we hadn't traditionally been a part of, like the creative entertainment industries. After training in Jamaica and returning to the UK, I tried for 3 years to get an equity card so that I could audition for work as an actor. The main problem was there weren't many parts for people of African descent at the time. But eventually, I got a job in a small company that had a card it could give to a new actor. Hurrah, I thought, I was set up. No. Theatre is a harsh master. While the work came, especially in theatre and education, community theatre and small-scale touring companies, the pay was not good. You couldn't feed a gerbil on what actors were paid in theatre. The money was in TV adverts and drama, and the joke amongst black actors was, if you were male, your best chance of getting a job was as the accused in the police drama The Bill. And if you were a woman, the role was mother of the accused. For anything other than that, there were 5 female actors who tended to get those jobs, and I wasn't one of them. So, in the mid to late 1990s, after working as an actor for 13 years, I decided to try my hand as a writer. I figured it couldn't be harder than trying to be an actor. I started telling everyone who would listen that I was a writer, and one day, to my utter surprise, I got a call from Paulette Randall, a writer-director I knew who was working for Sir Lenny Henry's company, Crucial Films. There was an offer of a job if I could come up with an idea for a short script as part of a series called Still Here, commissioned to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Windrush landing. While we were on the phone, an idea jumped into my head. My episode was called House of Usher, about a young woman of African Caribbean descent who was determined to see the R&B singer Usher. That short 10-minute script opened doors and windows for me, which included co-writing 2 seasons of the TV rating smash Coming At Ya, a vehicle for pop group Cleopatra, signed by Madonna's record label. Next up was being invited onto the writing team behind the BAFTA-nominated adaptation of Jacqueline Wilson's The Story of Tracy Beaker. My agent was so pleased with me. Every time she put me up for a writing job or to meet with production companies about my own series ideas, 7 out of 10 times I'd get a meeting. This is more like it, I thought. But 5 years in, and the whole thing ground to a halt, and not just for me. In the space of a couple of years, the writing jobs dried up for women writers of African and Asian descent. From the early to mid-2000s, some of us managed to get the odd gig on continuing dramas, also known as soaps, but creating original series or working on the big 9 o'clock shows were no longer in our reach. And this wasn't about merit. We'd been getting the jobs, writing the scripts, getting good reviews. It seemed that black and brown folk were no longer in fashion. But there is more than one way to skin a cat. For years, I banged on doors and thrust my scripts into producers' hands. What they told me time after time was that the commissioners thought there was no audience for work like mine about families, lawyers, midlife women, female friends, or anything that wasn't about the tiny percentage of young people of African and African Caribbean descent who die at the hands of gangs. so I decided to try something new. In 2011, I set up my company, Fresh Voices UK. I raised some money and used my BAFTA membership to pry open some doors. I decided to get a group of actors together to present a script-in-hand performance at BAFTA for an audience of producers from production companies who make shows and commissioners, the people who make the decision about what will be shown on TV. And I went further. I also decided to invite an audience of ordinary people to watch this performance. And I put together a panel of a writer, a director, and a BBC commissioner to give their feedback on the script. I held a series of these events to demonstrate to the TV industry that there was an audience that wasn't all black and brown, but a truly racially mixed audience who wanted to see work that showed Britishness in all its glory. It worked. The industry turned up, the audience came out, the script was a hit. We went from putting on performances to working with Directors UK, the National Association for Screen Directors, putting them together with writers. There was an event at ITV with guest CEO Andy Harris, who'd given me my second commission, and a series of boot camps for writers supported by Skillscreen and the London Film School to help writers of African and Asian descent put together that killer original script needed to get work in the industry. We started a movement eventually picked up by the rest of the industry. In 2021, as I write, we've come a long way from that half a dozen writers of African and Asian descent working on continuing dramas. Our writers now work all over the world. And now, it's time to do the same for midlife women of African descent. The stories by midlife women of African descent are rarely told in film and television, but they are occasionally told in theatre. And I know TV production companies love playwrights. What's not to love? We create great characters and explore big ideas. And I've never met a TV exec who didn't love a big idea. So in 2019, I created a project, Raised Voices, to amplify the plays of women of African descent over 45. I enlisted the help of a friend who helped shape the project, persuaded two theatres in London to support the project before applying to the Royal Society of Literature for a Literature Matters Award. As COVID-19 hit the UK and we went into the first lockdown, we heard we'd got the award. Then we heard the theatres were closing. But we know that project is just postponed, not cancelled. We thought we'd have to wait for another day to be heard. In the meantime, to paraphrase the words of the 1939 British government World War II motivational poster, we'd keep writing and supporting each other and carry on until the theatres reopened. Then everything changed. I can't breathe. Those three words reverberated around the world. Those of us who had heard those words before from Eric Garner in 2014 were haunted by the similarity. We'd seen the smartphone footage of a New York police officer holding him in a chokehold then. This time we heard them from George Floyd, another African-American man begging for his life on the 25th of May, 2020, as three policemen knelt on him for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, one of them on his neck. After 8 minutes and 46 seconds, he was dead. His death, like Eric Garner's, was captured on smartphones, the mainly black people filming the incident, pleading with the police to get off his neck and let him breathe. George Floyd's death sparked outrage in the hearts of people of African descent in America and Europe. We all knew why he had died like that, in the street, calling for his mama. The footage flew around the world from smartphone to smartphone, and the outrage grew as we heard about Breonna Taylor, who'd been shot in her bed 8 times in March. And before we could recover, we heard about Ahmaud Arbery, chased by 3 men in 2 flatbed trucks and shot dead in the street. That was on my birthday, the 23rd of February. Our outrage poured out into the streets, where we were joined by a diverse group of people protesting George's death.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.